like to call the meeting of the Charter Review Commission to order.
Present.
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 Here.
Present.
Here.
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 Thank you. We have a quorum. Mr. Cherry, would you lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Our agenda this evening, I would like to make a change to our agenda. We have a special presentation, and so I would like to list that after minutes of the previous meeting. Does anyone have any other items of concern for the agenda? All right. Thank you. The minutes of the previous meeting, there was quite a bit of transcription that was required, so the minutes are not ready at this time, and they will be emailed. Thank you. All right. Okay. Well, I'm very pleased to announce tonight that we do have a special presentation. Mr. Carl Bukowski, Attorney Carl Bukowski, who is the trustee for Chapter 13 and a former commissioner for the 1974 review program, and we are so happy to have him tonight. And would you?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Chairwoman. Fortunately, I got notice of this quite recently. I say fortunately because when I'm asked to speak, I usually get pretty nervous and spend a lot of time writing everything out, getting it all in order and all that stuff. Well, frankly, I didn't have time this time, so it's off the cuff. I should have at least put some bullet points down, but I was kind of busy today and didn't get to it. So if I tend to ramble too much, pull the rug out from under me, I can handle that. I do have a couple points I want to make, or a couple of comments. First of all, sort of a what spur of the moment kind of a thing, is I went back to pick up your handout on the public involvement, public outreach, and I noticed some pictures up there of city commission members. I urge you to get your picture of your commission soon. Well, you're all young and healthy, do it now. Not that anybody's going to hang it on any wall or it's all that important to anybody in the world except you. You're going to like to have one of those as the years go on. We did eventually get a picture of our charter commissioners, but we did it unfortunately after one of our members had passed away. So I do have a picture of eight of us, and it's a very valued part of memorabilia that I have on display in my office. So you might think that's a bunch of nonsense, but do it. You might not seem important today, but down the road you'll be glad you did it. I thought one of the things I could offer you is sort of a, since this is designed to be a blast from the past, one of the things I can offer you is sort of the current setting of the city of Flint, let's say politically, at the time the Charter Commission in 74 came into existence. So I'll give you a little bit of the political background, some of it's borderline gossip. Tom Donilon is here. His memory on this stuff is usually a whole lot better than mine, and I wish I would have run some of this past him, but if you have further questions, Tom can help fill in the blanks, because he was here through all that too. But if you think there's little faith in government today, you've all heard of and been well aware of and maybe lived through, to some extent, the impeachment process of Richard Nixon. Well, our Charter Commission met during his impeachment period. He left office in August of 1974. We met through the calendar year of 1974. So that was kind of hanging over a lot of the things we did. So transparency, checks and balances, fear of ogres running government was quite prevalent in our thinking. So we wanted checks and balances. That's very candidly why the ombudsman's in there. That's very candidly why certain things are in there that you might wonder, why did they, you know, want what they have? Well, we didn't want a runaway mayor. So it was, there are certain checks in there if you read it carefully, so we never have had a runaway mayor, even though we refer to him as a strong mayor. Point being, the goal was also transparency. That word wasn't in our vocabulary to this extent, like we're using it today, but openness in government was an important concept that the Charter Commission operated on. Why? Well, because of what was going on in Washington. A lot of stuff was going on there where, you know, the plumbers were going in and raiding this and that, and exposés were coming out. We wondered, you know, what in the world is going on with our government in Washington? We all, you know, took those classes in school and believed that things were pretty nice among our elected officials. We find out some of them were crooks. So transparency, openness, was a thing that we thought was important. So we did go out of our way to include as much transparency as possible in the writings of the charter, but also more importantly, in our process. So I do have a copy now of your public involvement report, and I want to compliment you on this. This is very important. You have a much more difficult time getting public involvement than we did. As I'm looking around, I don't see only but two people that might fit that category of public involvement. I didn't have any trouble finding a place to park out in front. I wondered when I came tonight how far away I'd have to park. Well, I'm sad to say I parked right in front. You have to find some way of getting the public involved in this. Okay, how was it different back in 73 and 74? Again, this is the borderline gossip part of it. We had a city manager system that was sort of an old boy network for a good number of years. Nobody rocked the boat, it sort of did its own thing. Civil rights came along, we had then more diversity in our city council, and things began to open up a little bit. So the old boy network was cracking. We had some diversity coming in, and it might not sound like a whole lot of diversity, but ethnic diversity, as well as some people were brought in from outside of town. We had a finance director and a new city manager brought in right out of public administration kinds of degrees from Yale, as I recall. Okay, so they're outsiders, type of diversity, coming in to sort of crack the old boy network to bring professionalism into the city of Flint government. Well, the city manager came in and he took his new office and he got the charter out and looked it over and then scratched his head and said, wait a minute, I thought I was gonna be city manager of this town. I find out that my hands are tied. I can't have the freedom to pick people to assist me in my job as city manager. I've got a civil service commission that runs all my personnel. I can't hire and fire. In fact, the personnel for Hurley Hospital was run through the Civil Service Commission of the city of Flint. So it was, and there was a parks commission, it ran the parks. Well, you'd think the city manager would have some control over the parks, but he didn't. They had a parks commission took care of that. So you can see that the new city manager looked at it and said, wow, I got a problem here. I can't run this city as a city manager. So he began to blow the horn for charter revision. And believe it or not, in those days, would there be a journal reporter here at the city council meetings, and they gobbled this stuff up. Here you got a city manager telling the city and his bosses, the city council, that the whole form of government's got to change. So this is pretty exciting stuff. So the public began to get aware. Something's going on down at City Hall. Outsider comes in, this fancy guy, and he's stirring things up. And of course, his job is teetering. And you know, how long is he going to last if he's causing problems in the pool that appointed him? So sure enough, as time went on, he was dismissed. But he did create enough interest in the public, and particularly in the editors and, well, let's say the editors at the Flint Journal, that they began to editorialize, they began to run articles, they sensitized the public as to what the needs were, and I know I'm getting mighty close, if not passing my 5 minutes. So you can pull the rug anytime you want. I'm responsive. I can wrap up if you say wrap up. Okay, thank you. The editorials began to take effect. People realized that maybe there is a different way of running. I mean, if you're only know one way of doing things, it's the only way you know, so you keep on trucking, and that's the way it is. But the public became sensitized that maybe there's a better way of dealing with City Hall. There were stories that maybe there was a investor or some developer wanted to come to Flint, maybe General Motors, and they wanted to build a new this or that, and they got kicked around from one office to the other and couldn't get things done. It became apparent that the city was balkanized. You had a sort of a little government here and a little piece of the government here, a little piece of the government here. Nobody could command the kind of attention that developers needed when they came to the city of Flint. So the Journal then became convinced that change was required. So we rode into the office of the Charter Commission on a white horse. I mean, we knew that we had a mandate to make change. We believed that an elected mayor was what was probably the best thing. I'm not saying it was a foregone conclusion, but that was pretty much what we felt the public wanted. So I think the moral to take from that story that I just gave you is read your environment. Get the public involved. Find out what the public wants so that all your work that you're going to do will be eventually accepted by the electorate, either through their votes, if that's required, or through their adherence if and when that time comes. So public involvement is probably one of the most important things that you can set your steps out. I know you've already decided this. I can tell by the handout I just looked at. I'm sorry I'm going to be out of town on the 26th, or I'd be here to help you celebrate and kick off. I don't want to say you've been invisible so far, folks, but I run into Tom now and then and ask him what's happening, and he tells me that he's virtually the only observer. We had observers from not only the Flint Journal, but the UAW was active in this town in those days. They would come, they'd have a representative, maybe several representatives, watching, reporting back, talking to charter commissioners. We had the representatives from the League of Women Voters who were very interested in what we were doing. They would keep track of things and through their network help disseminate information. We had a public information officer whose particular job was to get information out to the public. So I don't know how you could assess the public today, what your reading is. You were elected for reasons, you've got a constituency, you will assess what the city needs, but do what you can to get as much public involvement. Enough said on that. I did bring, and I can wrap up now, I did bring a copy of a handout. You all have seen this before. I passed these out at some of the sessions that were going on through that Blue Ribbon Committee thing. Hopefully you read some of this. I'm going to leave this with your secretary with the hope that somehow maybe you could copy the first couple pages. It gives a good narrative. If you want a glimpse into the past as to what it was like then, why we did what we did, it's the narrative is pretty good here. I just reread it this evening before I came. I can't improve on the language here. If you want some history of what happened, there it is. I will leave it. I'm about out of them. I did my best to give them all away, and I almost completed the job. I'm ready to sit down and be quiet. I do understand, though, you may have questions, and I'll be glad to answer them.
Yes. Commissioners?
I have a question. What is your thoughts on, just thoughts, because we will have to work toward a goal of having it on a, finishing up our work and having it on a ballot at some point in time. What is your thoughts on a November election versus a election any other time of the year? Does it really make a difference, or?
You're getting deep into politics. You've got to talk to your best political advisors and go for that. If you want lots of involvement, you go for the November date. Mm-hmm. If you want to slip it by with a bunch of committed people who are dedicated to it, pick the lesser populated election day. No way of telling yet where you're going to be on that issue. I hope you light some fires so that people are interested and want to show up in favor of your deliberations. But on the other hand, you're right in perceiving that that's one of the most significant decisions you'll make. Let's make this clear. You're political people. You might think this is going to be an academic exercise. Mm-hmm. You're going to, you know, do some academic drafting and come up with some language that meets the needs. But you're going to get political, too. You want your work to be adopted.
Right.
And the question you just asked is a very, very important question. I can't answer that in the abstract. But you hit the nail on the head. Yeah. It's an important question. I must have said something controversial or whatever. You got to come back at me with something. Go ahead.
Nothing controversial, but you mentioned that there was kind of a uniting is probably the wrong word, a general sentiment when you came in as a commission that there was a public outcry for a change in governance. As you went through the bulk of writing the charter, did you essentially kind of take the existing one and go through each section and say kind of how do we feel, the public feels about our council?
It's a good question, too. That was one of the things we talked about. In fact, that may be one of the things you could pick up if you read the thing here. We went at it initially like we're going to school. We hired Tom Donilon, we hired Peter Gluck from U of M, who is a political science professor who understands all about governments, local governments. So we had classes. Tom told us what the Home Rule Act was all about, what we could do, what we couldn't do, how that operated, what we had to do, and blah, blah. So he's our legal advisor. Then Peter Gluck said, here's the way they do it in Philadelphia, or in Lansing, this is the kind of charter they've got. And he laid out lots of different kinds of apparatus that we could adopt. So we started out basically with a bunch of photocopies of pages that our experts brought us so we understood where we were going. We did not take the existing charter and go through paragraph by paragraph. There were several members of the Charter Commission who said we ought to do that. But I think wisely, we said, no, we want to reject the existing charter. We want to scrap it and write one from beginning to end that is new and different. So you've got that option now. Maybe you haven't discussed it, but it's an option you have. Start from the ground up, or take it piecemeal and make some changes here and there. Just because you start from the ground up doesn't mean you're going to ignore parts of it that are still good today. You might modify it a little bit, but you might take it carte blanche and put it right in the new one. We did that in several areas. Some of the stuff is so sensitive, like finance. You don't want to tinker that too much. You make people nervous. You're going to somehow or another make it difficult for the city. I got to watch this. Make it difficult for the city to meet its budget. I guess we did a pretty poor job of that. But we tried to make it such that it would be harder to tinker with finance. I think you can say we failed on that.
I've got another question.
Yes.
In the news letter you got there, news journal, it mentions that a citizen advisory group. I'd like to know more about how that was formalized. I guess your information consultant was instrumental in putting that together and how important they were.
We had several things going on. Mm-hmm. We had a member of our commission, Joe Conroy, who was very committed to seeking and listening to members of the public. So the Citizens Advisory Board was pushed by Joe Conroy. He wanted it and would often speak in behalf of the public to make sure that we took them into account and listened to them. Our meeting started just like this. And we listened to the public as they came in, and we went out of our way to invite certain, let's say our topic was on management or personnel, what am I trying to say, human resources kind of stuff. We'd send letters out and say, okay, on such and such a day, we'd like people to come and be aware that we'll talk about this certain topic. We also went so far as to invite, let's say, the civil service commissioners to come and give their insights into what we ought to be doing. One of the chairman of the then existing Civil Service Commission came and spoke like this, and he was passing things out and came by. I was up there as chair of the outfit, and I said to him, his name was Carl Bloom. I said, Carl, we've got a 2-minute rule or 5-minute or whatever, but if you need a couple more, take a little more time because I know this is complicated, because he handed out quite a few pages. Well, sure enough, it was complicated. What he did was a total surprise to everybody in the world. But he recommended we abolish the Civil Service Commission. And here he is, the chairman of the Civil Service Commission. So yeah, there was some lively stuff going on. We wanted the public involved, but it wasn't just like running up a flag. You kind of have to go and do so.
I'd like to ask, go back to the advisory group. And seeking information and input from the group, one of the things we had discussed in one of our committee meetings, well, what do you do when the writing starts? And
okay, that's a good distinction. I started to get into that a moment ago. Mm-hmm. We started our meeting here and listened to the public. When the public part of the meeting was over, we went back in there, rolled up our sleeves. In those days, we all smoked like crazy. The room was filled with smoke, and that's when we got down to the drafting. We had a secretary who took down all our minutes, and typically we would hear a report from one of our consultants. A prior meeting, we'd say, Tom, write us something that would authorize this or that. And so he'd have a presentation. Here's some draft language. Here's a couple of ways you can say it. So we'd look it over and discuss it, debate it, and make some changes. And that would be our first reading. And then we had rule, I forget what it was, it would sit for a few weeks for discussion purposes. Then we have a second reading, which basically meant it was going to be adopted or as part of the charter. And then the final reading was a third reading to get, you know, it all put together. So we didn't allow, I keep forgetting to say this, we did not allow public comment once we got back in there. It was strictly for us to roll up our sleeves and get down to business. But there was an important there's a good word for this. It was all taken down in shorthand. So we had good minutes of it so that we could go back, and if I wanted to know what I said then, it was always in the minutes, so we could keep track of what we decided the week before and all that. So we relied on good, strong minutes. I'm sad to hear, I may be wrong, but I'm sad to hear you don't have much in the way of a budget for staff. Of course, you're coming about this a whole lot different than the nice parade that we were able to lead in here. I hope you can get past that.
All right, thank you. Anyone else? Questions?
I have a question.
Sure.
Two questions. One, because several times you've mentioned that the 74 Commission really wanted to hear what the public had to say. After your third reading, before the Commission voted, did you have a final public reading before the vote? Or did you just have the public speak, then you debated, came out, and voted without the public hearing why you want to make those changes at all, and you just voted?
I'm not sure I understand your question, but I'll try and answer it the way I think you're asking it. You want to know, did the public have a chance to comment on what we were doing back in there?
No, sir. At your third reading,
yes.
You have public comment? And then you go back in the room, you talk about whatever it is that you wanted to make a proposal, changes. When you came back out here at the third reading, did you just come out and vote? Or did you let the public know this is what the discussion was, this is the changes that we're going to make, and the public did or did not have an opportunity to speak to that before you voted?
The public always had an opportunity to speak. We never cut them off. And by the time it came to third reading, it was pretty clear to the public what we were doing. They had plenty of chances before then to come in and say what they wanted. And we heard from them.
Okay.
They'd stand here and say, you did something stupid last week. You shouldn't have done that. I mean, we heard that kind of stuff.
The second question that I had is, what is your gut feel where the public is today as far as any changes to be made or not made to the charter?
I don't think there's a consensus. No, I think you got a very difficult job because I don't think the public has spoken in a loud and clear way on any issue I can think of at the moment. There are pieces that would come to mind, but insofar as having, let's say, overwhelming support for any particular point, I can't tell you what that would be. Now, others may have better reading of the community than I do, but I don't see it as having any particular issue having great allegiance. I think there is a feeling that because of the financial trouble Flint's been in, that there should be something firmer insofar as ability to make a budget and stick to it. I think that one above all, and I may be speaking more of the environment that I just went through as part of that Blue Ribbon Committee thing, because I had this role in 74, I was asked to be on that Blue Ribbon thing, and one of the things we talked about at some length there was the need to have some teeth in a charter so that money doesn't get from here to there and be misspent. And I don't know how you can do that. I mean, people are people, and I don't know. God bless you if you can come up with a good way of making that happen.
Okay. No other questions? Thank you so much, Mr. Dawson.
My pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I never thought I'd be around at this point in my life or in this era to be able to make these comments. It's certainly a pleasure to have an ability to talk. And if you ever want to talk about this more, you can tell I'm a pretty good talker. Give me a call.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Mr. West will be with us on the 24th. Okay. All right. Next is public comments. And we have Mr. Mitchell. 3 minutes, please.
My name is R.L. Mitchell, and I reside at 759 East of Linden Street on Northside. I like this, what the speaker had said before me just now. He mentioned something about in 1974, Richard Nixon was impeached. And then the public service of you guys, one of them, checked him while he was talking and said, you got 2 minutes to sum up, but he, in them 2 minutes, he canceled the public service and put it out of commission, and he is in commission today. That's what I want to speak on about. Last night I signed, the day I signed up for what my topic is, mankind, that's my topic. And last night I was in the council meeting, and mankind, it was corruption in there of a chair lady. And one of the councilmen went outside and accidentally got locked out. But he had to call the chair lady like you to get back in. But before he got back in, they tried to close the meeting, and he tried to speak, and it went on from there just like he was just speaking. When they went back in the committee room back in the day, they smoking and stuff, and they didn't allow the public can speak, but they can go back there and watch. That's what happened last night. You notice there ain't no public peoples in here. Ain't nary one of them in here, but I appreciate this guy, what he's talking about. Because I was around when just turned teenager when they massacred that preacher man, his concerned pastor, Martin Luther King. I remember seeing that. Then they put Johnson in, then they put Nixon in. After that, they impeached the guy. And this strong mayor come along in Detroit, young. But we got a strong man, Flint, Woodrow Stanley, he just left. That don't say he's a weak mayor, but he says y'all want him to leave, he'll leave. He just made a remark like this, the guy talking about public service. And he can retake his place anytime right now, as you people sit up there and don't want to ask this man comments, but had a smile on their face, but he's surprised that nobody really checked him. And,
thank you.
Oh, no, wait.
Thank you, Mr. Mitchell.
Thank
you. Your
right,
time's
cool.
up.
Right.
Thank you. Okay, let's move on. Reports. Our first report is from Commissioner Cherry regarding a proposal. Have an extra?
Yeah.
Would you leave one for the attorney? He could not be here tonight.
So So the last commission meeting, I had talked about reaching out to the Ford School of Public Policy at the University of Michigan, and I had done that. And when I had talked to them, the applied policy seminar was, school starting up. So the applied policy seminar where they get a lot of grad students to do work on municipal issues was starting up, so there was a really quick turnaround on sending them a proposal. So I communicated with the chair and put together a proposal that we submitted to Elizabeth Gerber, who's a professor at the Ford School of Public Policy. And just a little bit of information on that. They provide services to local municipalities, act as consultants, free of charge as a public service to those municipalities as part of their public mission as a public university within the state of Michigan. And so we put together a quick proposal for them to do some research for us and submitted it. We found out that the work is not going to be able to be done through the applied policy seminar, but there's potentially some other avenues within the Ford School that we can get some assistance from grad students to do research for us on a number of different topics that we had talked about at the work session, essentially doing a lot of research on other cities and what charter provisions they have and looking at some of our charter provisions and what have you. But thought I'd pass this out. It kind of has details of information that we had thought would be useful for them to research for us.
Any questions regarding the proposal?
Which U of M school is this?
University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, the Ford School of Public Policy.
It's the Gerald R. Ford.
And I have a question, another question. If these graduate students are coming from Ann Arbor, how will they be able to know or have a feel for what the community needs are if they are residing in Ann Arbor and not in Flint as a U of M student?
One of the aspects of the proposal talks about them participating in our public outreach so that they can understand what the needs of the community are through the comments of our citizens and the input that we'll get from our citizens, in addition to doing background work on the city of Flint itself, our history, and the situation within the city.
Also, I see here number two under research here on your second page. They be doing some research in response to what other municipalities are doing also. We need that input, I'd say, also.
Yeah, and part of it is doing interviews with commissioners, civic leaders that we ask them to interview, and both inside and outside City of Flint and commissioners.
Is this a cost since they live in Ann Arbor and would have to travel to Flint to do their work?
No, they have their own budget for travel expenses and what have you.
Commissioner Richardson.
Thank you. Mr. Cherry, how long a time frame would they be able to function with us? If a semester ends, what happens the next semester? If the year ends and we're not, do we still?
Well, if it was the applied policy seminar, they provide a report out to us in December, but since we're looking at alternative avenues now, it could be a semester, it could be a year, it depends on the structure, because it would probably be an independent study with graduate students.
So it would be graduate students.
Correct.
Would it be under the direction of one particular faculty member?
Yeah, Elizabeth Gerber focuses, her focus is on municipal governance, and she would be the person under whom it would be directed.
So there could be some consistency over time if graduate students change. Sounds like a great idea. Thank you.
And I'm sorry we could not, give you the information earlier, to the time frame. As a matter of fact, the students, the information for the students, they would have selected on yesterday. And also, because of the policy of the city of having to post meetings and so forth, we could not communicate with all of you on this. And so that is why we took the initiative to move forward with it. And so even though this particular proposal, we would not be able to do it now, however, we still want to look at other avenues with Ms. Gerber. And so I would suggest, unless you have other questions, I would suggest that a motion be made to support this project. And also, I would also suggest that if you would go online, there's some magnificent work being done by these young people and have been done. And I would suggest that you go online and take a look at some of the work that they've accomplished with different municipalities and organizations.
I have a question. So they're on board for this semester, is that, or we're still waiting to find
out? Yeah, we haven't, this is not solidified as it's going to happen yet. We're working on making it happen, yeah.
Okay. I'd like to make a motion to support the proposal submitted by Commissioner Cherry as presented.
Support.
Questions?
I would like to know if the U of M Flint was contacted with this proposal to see if any of their graduate students were available.
No, I'm not aware of the people at U of M Flint, so I don't have contact with them.
And this is specific to the Gerald R. Ford School at the University of Michigan. Mm-hmm. It would not, U of M Flint would not have been a part of it.
We did talk about this too at the last meeting, yes. and Commissioner Cherry asked for some feedback on what kinds of things that they could help with, and I see those comments are in here, and thank you for getting that done.
Any other questions? Okay. Move for the vote.
Yes.
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 No.
Yes.
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 Thank you. Motion passed. Thank you. And I'd like to thank Mr. Cherry. He literally did this overnight, writing this proposal, and I'd like to thank him for that.
Appreciate it.
Okay, our next is our Finance Committee. Commissioner Wesley?
Yes, you have before you the summary of our meeting this past Tuesday, September the 8th. We dealt with unfinished business. We had been requested at the last meeting of the whole that we consider providing, financing the provision of Robert's Rule of Order books for everyone, the newest edition. And we discussed it, and it was proposed at the finance meeting, and we bring it here for discussion, that it was recommended that the chairperson, Ms. McGee, and the Rules Committee Chair, Victoria McKenzie, both be provided with those books. With the others, either you purchase them on your own or we provide them if you so desire, but mainly those two people would be provided with those books. So I'd like to throw that out for discussion now and maybe a decision. No, can't do that. Just get through the report.
I will purchase my book so that we'll have.
Okay, one has been purchased.
Matter of fact, I can just purchase both and bring them. I'll just bring it.
Okay, two have been purchased. So, you know, if other members desire to have one, the discussion is open for such. They're pretty thick. No. Okay, we'll move on then. We discussed some finances that were pretty large in our budget, and as you know, we're constrained with our budget. So our legal consultant, we're gonna go with David Roth, part of the law department here. He'll be providing us with ongoing support for our concerns and writing of the charter, of questions in writing the charter as to the scope of the Charter Review Commission and how we go through this process and making changes. At the August 27th meeting, he did pass out a review of Article 1. I don't know if everyone has had a chance to read that, but it was pretty detailed. At any rate, with that suggestion in hand, we can save, if you look back at what our proposed budget for that individual was, the $33,600. And pretty substantial. Also with the municipal governance consultant, this person, as Mr. Bukowski said, was invaluable in providing them information as to options, as what is currently out there in practice, best practices, if you will. We have the MML. They gave a very excellent work session with us. I think we'd all agree. And they have agreed or suggested that they would help us on an as-needed basis and provide services for review of our documents and questions. And possibly, as we just discussed, the U of M Ford School of Public Policy. With those two, we think we can get most of our municipal governance consulting questions asked, and we would like to reduce some of those expenses of $38,400 as dictated in our budget. And with those two together, we could certainly throw at our public outreach, Heidi, public outreach some monies. And as you can, as you heard from Mr. Bukowski, he was very clear on making sure we got more participation from our public. And so those monies would be very handy and making that happen, I would say. I know Heidi would agree with that. And along in that same meeting on Tuesday, we discussed some suggestions. We know Heidi has a September 26th kickoff. We have a September 26th kickoff of this charter review. And she's budgeted $22.20 for that. We wondered, was that enough marketing associated with it? She had designated $300, and I'm thinking that's for flyers, if I'm correct. And we need to get the word out there, or we'll be sitting in an echoing room somewhere at U of M. But we need to get the word out there. So along with that discussion came these other listed on the second page of what we can do. The main thing we'd like to leave with, if it's at all possible, is put in the hands of those who do show up a copy of the charter, the present charter. I know it doesn't contain the amendments, but something that they can walk away and discuss. I don't know if that's possible. It's possible. Okay, we'd like to put that in their hands. And out of those nine listed, I have some corrections there. The television point, channel 12, 25, and 5, we wanted public service announcements, not ads, unless they're reduced in cost substantially. The yard signs, I had the company listed as LGM. It is LGEM1@.com. And that was suggested by Commissioner McKenzie. She's used them before, and they're reusable signs given the fact that you can remove letters and use them subsequent to whatever you want to use them with. But at any rate, we need to get these out. We need to help Heidi formulate some costs. So anybody have access to any information in formulating costs and help her formulate budgets for these upcoming public events so the Finance Committee can you know, try to get our funds together and direct toward her. It would be really, really good. And that's pretty much what we discussed. The meeting was adjourned. Next meeting is September 22nd.
I would like to say that we have a meeting that's being scheduled with Kimberly Roberson at the Mott Foundation, CS Mott Foundation. Kimberly is the director for the Flint program, and she will be meeting also, I'm sure, with a program officer. So that meeting should be scheduled very soon because we may, of course, we will probably need more funding in the future as we move on. So we still want to try to seek funds through the foundation and other means. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Any questions for the Finance Committee?
I would just like to thank the Finance Committee for spending some time, you know, helping think through ways to improve our outreach. And I would, love the additional support. We are going to have to schedule another public outreach meeting to really be prepared for this. Mm-hmm. I feel that, you know, every other week is going to be fine in most cases, but this time we're going to need to have another meeting next week.
Next
so
week.
Maybe we can talk more about a date or time that that works for folks. Is it possible that we could allocate some dollars to put to these elements so that folks could start? I'm thinking about the timing between now and our next meeting. So approving of additional expenditures for advertising, we'd have to make that approval tonight, I feel, in order for us to be able to spend those funds before the 26th.
I would ask, what do we feel would be the biggest bang for the dollars spent in such a short period of time to get the notice out to people? Mm-hmm. Is it radio? Is it some other media, television? You want to spend dollars, but you want to cover the broadest coverage you could of the public out there and let them know. Because mm-hmm. there will be some that says, I didn't know about this or I would have attended. We want to make our dollars work hard.
I would suggest ads in the Courier and the Journal.
Ads in the Courier and the Journal? Do we know what those dollars would be? Any clue? Okay.
Well, with the Courier, I know the range is around, according to the size, $100 to $200, but I'm sure the Journal will be more.
The Courier, a good ad would run about $400 to $500
for the Courier.
That's a large ad.
Well, the ad that I put in when I was running costs $450.
And that was a full page, I think.
No, that was about
half a page.
Quarter page. Eighth of a page.
What's their circulation? I'm not sure. I know they have them. They bring them to free of charge at Hurley's lobby, and they seem to disappear right away. So I know that's the distribution. We've got 2,500-plus employees, so that's a good deal.
I don't know any of the concerned pastors personally, mm-hmm. and that might make a difference who approaches them to get an article, whether it's free or you pay full price.
We discussed speaking to Reverend Harris, was the chair or director.
Okay. So Courier is somewhere in the hundreds, 500 or less.
It's according to size.
I'd like to suggest that we allocate an additional $1,000 for marketing purposes.
For the 26th?
For the 26th.
I support that. Were you proposing?
It was not a motion.
It was not a motion.
I was running that up the flagpole to see what would happen, if how many folks would if anybody would choke or, respond or react.
I was going to say something similar, regardless of what the dollar amount is, given the concerns of Commissioner Fanoff. I believe if we can just allocate a certain amount that we allow them to make the decisions on that we're comfortable with, and they can figure out, because right now we won't be able to get these key figures answered in this meeting session, but if we are comfortable with whatever that amount is, we can say that, and then the chairs of the Finance and Public Outreach Committee can get with the chair of the commission and decide how best to utilize that for the event.
I think that would make sense, mm-hmm. just for the sake of discussion purposes here tonight.
I think that's good, too.
Okay, looks like folks are sort of in support. So, Madam Chair, I move that we allocate $1,000 towards advertisement for the community meeting on the 26th.
A second. Four.
Okay. Question? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Oh, I'm sorry. I forgot. You're going to have to raise your hands if we do it this way, because she has to. Okay. Does anyone oppose? Everyone said aye, right?
Aye.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. All right. Next is Rules Committee.
No report.
Public outreach.
Thank you, Madam Chair. There is a public outreach committee report that's here for you guys, and I'm gonna hit a couple highlights and then spend the majority of the time talking about the kickoff meeting. So I first wanna thank Janelle for getting our website up and running, really appreciate that. So, and we can continue to add more pieces to it and such as we go on. We talked at the committee meeting last night about making a couple changes to kind of think of it as, you know, lighter, quicker, cheaper charter commission. We needed to get some things ready and out for print and decided that instead of going with City of Flint email at cityofflint.com, we would ask the commissioners, and you all received an email from me tonight asking for your preferred email to be used for public purposes. It'll also help you for not having to check too many emails. So if you get it at cityofflint.com, you're going to have to, you know, check another email. So we recommend that we just get business cards that include our current email then, and just tell me what you prefer. The same with phone number. Let me know if you want your personal phone number or cell phone number on there, and also if you prefer to keep those numbers private, it's okay to just put the clerk's number on there. Yes.
Did you say that you are sending us an email tonight and we just respond to it with those answers?
You received it before the meeting, and when you get home, you can respond to it.
Okay, thank you.
We also are not going to put the pictures on the business cards because that's kind of been problematic to get that in, so we're just going to move on without the pictures. So all these items will go to the printer. We want to have them out Monday. So if you could get me your information, you know, by the end of the weekend, then we can have drafts that I'll email to you to just say, this looks good, and then we'll print.
What's the problem with that? What is the problem with the pictures?
I really can't speak to what the problem is. I just know I don't have them, and we're moving on.
Well, I have all the equipment
you
necessary.
Oh, a digital copy? Do you have a digital copy of the pictures? And we can produce and print them? I'm sorry, I've been communicating with Inez. Okay. Okay. Send them along. Can you send them tomorrow or tonight? Okay. Okay. Monday. All right, okay. So really, we just wanted to wrap that item up so we can, you know, get on to some of the other business.
Before you move on that, I do want, in case there are some hiccups regarding that, Commissioner Metcalf just said that he has all the equipment to take care of that, if necessary.
Yes.
Okay. Well, it sounds like we'll get them. And I'm sorry, I didn't mean to, I just assumed. We had a meeting last night and we were just ready to move on. We were just making it happen.
So you do have the, we do have the CD of the pictures?
She has the CD of the pictures.
Heidi, sorry to jump back to this. So mm-hmm. we're not going to get City of Flint emails? Okay.
I guess we've been talking about it for a long time, and I'd like to just, you know, we decided at the committee meeting last night to propose not doing at cityofflint.com emails. We talked right before the meeting yesterday, and she said she's still working with IT, and there's some issues with IT.
Okay. So
maybe it's something that we can do later.
I mean, I can just create a new Gmail account, but I would like it separate, but that just, I'll just need to notify everybody of my, I'll just make a new Gmail account. That'll be easy enough.
Okay, and so it might still happen, but we just need to get our stuff printed. Okay. So our Facebook page, we'll create, after we approve the flyer tonight, we'll create an event page for the kickoff meeting, and we'll have that up and running Saturday. Thank you, Spectacle Productions, for doing video recording of tonight, and there are going to be live streaming of our meeting, which I don't think has started yet. I have to talk with Paul on that. There is an advisory committee interest form that's ready for your approval tonight. It's in your packet. This would be a way for community members to share their interest being on the committee. There's not a deadline for when they need to submit it. We would ask that they be turned into the clerk's office, and then the clerk's office could set them aside, and there's a spot for recording when it's received and making a date for when it's received. We created these check boxes, which for some reason when I print them don't line up where they should be. They look in the right spot on my computer. It's interesting. Asking that they basically check these boxes to affirm these items, that they are City of Flint resident, they're willing to review and abide by the roles and responsibilities, which will be the opposite side of the sheet, so the two will be printed together. And pretty self-explanatory. We already looked at the roles and responsibilities previously. Does anybody have any thoughts on the form?
Heidi, just a thought occurred to me. If somebody checks, let's say, one of the boxes or doesn't check another box mm-hmm. or checks half the boxes, what does that mean in terms of that person's involvement? Do they have to check all the boxes in order to be on the advisory committee?
No, it doesn't really mean anything. It's a way for them to think about what they're committing to.
So if someone does not check the box that they would abide by the group agreements.
Well, when we get to the meeting, you know, they'll reaffirm that they're willing to abide by the group agreements. It's just a way to get people thinking about what the commitment will entail.
Okay.
And a way for us to know who's out there.
Yeah.
Another comment about the forum, to kind of piggybacking on Commissioner Richardson, are we saying that any of these are required? So are we saying that in order to be on the advisory committee, you have to be a City of Flint resident?
We did talk about that.
We did.
And we wanted it to be City of Flint residents. But if you have some thoughts on that.
I'm open. I mean, if the consensus of the commission is that they should be a resident, then it's fine. I could just imagine if there are individuals who maybe have extensive history in the city, who maybe have worked for a lot of years or go to an institution and just want to contribute. So for the most part, the advisory committee are individuals who are supporting our efforts, right? Mm-hmm. So I guess I look at it, unless we're gonna have them, like if you get like a specific vote and this vote means this part goes into the charter, that sort of piece, then I understand because they would be at that level, but it doesn't matter. If we agree to it, we agree to it.
Our reasons were really for the second part of your statement, and that was that we expected folks to be part of this to really share feedback and provide feedback that then would come to us at our next meeting. So we really wanted that feedback to come from City of Flint residents who we feel would be, those are the stakeholders that'll be voting on this product. Mm-hmm. And we didn't want too many outside influences that would, that, you know, thinking about it from a perspective of those out folks who are, do not live in the City of Flint may see things in a different way than City of Flint residents. And we wanted to make sure the City of Flint residents' voices were the loudest.
And that's fair, and they can come to meetings if they want to, if you're not a Flint resident. I think there's an opportunity for input in the fact that we're creating a document for the future of the city so there could be future residents or things like that, but if we don't want them on there, it's fine. I think what I did want to say, though, about the way that section is set up, if instead of the check boxes, we wanted to just make their signature confirm everything that we think is mandatory, then by signing this, you confirm to whatever, and that's why I asked about the resident thing. Whatever we say is mandatory, we just have our signature confirmed that, so you don't have to worry about the people. So, like, if you sign it, you agree to the rules, right? Because everybody wants to do that and that.
Right, but the group agreements haven't even been created yet by the advisory committee.
No, I mean the roles and responsibilities or whatever. Just a formatting opportunity, but that was the first thing. The second, can we have it on the website? Is it possible to have it on the website? That'd be really helpful.
So, a thought on the checkboxes, specifically the willing to abide by the group agreements. I think maybe we want to reword that just because there are no group agreements yet. And so it's difficult to say I want to abide by something that I don't know what it is.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Got any suggestions?
That you're going to read and try to stick to the intent of, that you're going to read the group agreements and that you're committed to running effective meetings or something along those lines.
Okay. All right. Great. Anything else on that?
Yes, please.
Sure.
I think that it's important that the advisory committee consist of Flint residents. I think that we need to be particularly sensitive to the general mood of our community, which seems to feel as though outsiders are dictating the direction that's happening. Mm-hmm. And I think that if we're sensitive, we need to be sensitive to the input that's coming in from the advisory group, the kind of in a quasi-official body of our group, our Flint citizens. Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean that the advisory committee couldn't receive information from somebody outside the group, but mm-hmm. it would be the quasi-official body, though, would be Flint residents. Mm-hmm. And I think that from the perspective of our need to intentionally create opposition to the work we're doing, I think that it would make sense to place that the members of the advisory committee be Flint residents.
Great. I think that makes sense.
Question? everyone that fills out an interest form will automatically be on the advisory committee?
Yep. Could have 5,000 people on the advisory committee. Love to get really big space. Maybe Atwood Stadium.
It's gonna be.
We can only hope.
It's gonna be awful December meetings.
Second question.
Uh-huh.
On your flyer, mm-hmm. Please spell my name correctly.
Oh, I'm sorry. Hey, no I E.
Correct.
Delete the I. Done.
And also the other question that I had regarding the flyer, at the top on the orange box, it has Saturday. Should the date be repeated again, even though it's in blue on the left-hand side? Should the date also be under Saturday, September 26, 2015, 10 a.m. to noon?
Sure. It's also down at the bottom as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's at the bottom of the orange box.
Do you guys feel we should add that in?
I think it couldn't hurt.
Sure, okay. Mm-hmm. Great.
One more final comment about the Flint resident piece, just because I brought it up and to respond back. I agree. I don't think we should. I don't think the commission needs to do anything to make it harder to do our job by any way. One thing I do think is important, and you addressed it, is that I don't want to limit the information we as commissioners can receive in any form. And I agree. I mean, we don't need to put any non-Flint residents in an official capacity. I was just thinking about how we can make sure we can get as much information as possible and for that. But I agree completely. We don't want to do anything to put an opposition before we've ever come up with one proposal or anything of that nature. So,
And I assume that we will have people attending the kickoff that live outside of the city. And I think it would be good to listen to their views and so forth. But again, I still think that the advisory committee should be city residents.
Great. Okay. So, other items. We still need more clerical support. Just didn't want to mention it because I feel like it's a broken, I'm saying as a broken record, but I want to continue to say that, like, the 74 Charter Commission had 3 staff, you know, and we have a little bit of a couple people's time, which is not the same thing. And it's really important that we get additional support for public outreach. And we're gonna get there. We're gonna get there. Okay. Regina Laurie is available and on board for a kickoff meeting and has been helping me work on developing the agenda, and will be more involved in the next 2 weeks as well. In fact, I'm hopeful that when we have our meeting, we could. I have a conference call line, and so if you can't make it down here to City Hall but could conference in for the conversation, that's an option as well. Okay. We did send the letters out to the 74 Commission. They went out late. Some of them were hand-delivered, but folks are coming, and we're glad to have that.
Have we gotten many reservations or confirmations?
Just the 2 that were mentioned so far. So there's 4 folks that are still around.
Okay.
Joe Conroy and Robert. Oh, John West is coming next time. Blanking on his name. He's the planning commissioner of the First Ward as well.
Mm-hmm. First Ward.
Robert Jackson. Robert Jackson.
That's right.
So we still need to hear from Robert Jackson and from Joel Conroy. We're also going to be sending out more letters, and Cleo's going to help with that for the other folks.
We're sending out letters to the League of Women Voters, to the unions. I can't remember who else.
There's a short list.
Yeah.
So we could get some of those folks here that, you know, mm-hmm. are interested in our work. Okay, kickoff meeting. I have attached the flyer. We already talked a little bit about it. A couple of the revisions have been noted. I'm really sorry about spelling your name wrong, Commissioner McKenzie, and we will put September the 26th up at the top. Overall, is there anything else that anybody would like to suggest?
Yes, you need to discuss what our role will be that day.
All right, so let's move on to
the
internal agenda.
Early?
No, that's okay. You're a little early, but if there's nothing else on the flyer besides those changes, I'd like to make those changes and then start getting them out this weekend at Flint Neighbors United and around the community. And we'll work with the clerk's office to get copies. So there's a draft internal agenda attached to the packet about the kickoff meeting. I wanted to state some of the important outcomes that we want to make sure that the reason we're meeting is so that the public learns about the charter review and also hears about ways to get involved. I also, in my email, asked everybody to give me a short bio, like maybe a paragraph, saying who you are and, you know, maybe a couple things about your qualifications or your interest in the charter or things that you do. It's really a way for the community to get to know you. So we would compile that and it would be a handout. So meet the charter commissioners and folks would get to keep that and take that with them. Yes.
All of us had to submit a bio to the League of Women Voters. Could you obtain a copy?
You could send that to me and I will use that. So that was also in the email that you guys got right before we came here today. So here's some ways to get the word out. Another couple of ones I want to just kind of say all the ones that are on the Finance Committee report are good, and then here's some other ones that we talked about. I would like to reach out to Ron Fonger, make an appointment with him to, thank you, Janelle. This is Janelle's suggestion, meet with Flint Journal and get Ron Fonger to basically get involved in our process. And Janelle does have press contacts that we can use to get our press release out. So I want to add press release and Ron Fonger to that, because he does do a lot of local government news, and he seems to be a pretty all right reporter person. So introductions at tables. So we'd start off knowing that people are going to come in the room, not all at 10 to 10:15. Yes?
So I was going to make, and you have it later in this packet, you know, on the exercise and stuff, but I think one of the outcomes that we might want to, if we're going to, like, package this into a press release, like why we're having a meeting, I think one of the outcomes we want to talk about is having an understanding of the values of the citizens of Flint when it comes to what they think municipal government should look like.
Thank you. Good. Making a note. Okay.
I'm sorry to interrupt your train.
No, that's great. So our icebreaker, Regina would lead the icebreaker. I don't know if you guys remember going to some community meetings where you had little clickers and you could vote automatically, and then everything was electronically uploaded to a PowerPoint presentation, and you could see what the consensus or what people were voting as a whole in the room. We'd like to use that during the icebreaker. That we'd then do some opening remarks and then agree on some group agreements at the beginning of the meeting to start working together.
Is that like group norms? Like how we interact with each other?
Yeah, like making sure everybody has an opportunity to speak, not speaking over one another, you know, keeping an open mind, turning your cell phone off, that kind of stuff.
No spit moments.
All right. Usually we would start off with some on the wall and then ask if anybody has anything they want to add, and then, you know, add a couple more. Everybody kind of agrees on them, and then we move forward with the meeting. So the presentation, so we're going to have to do a presentation that'll be by us on what is the charter, who are the Charter Review Commissioners? What's our task? What's the Charter Review process? Why do this? Why is it important? And I think that this why it's important piece can really help, I hope, inspire people to be involved in our process, because there's so much change that can happen through this charter review. People are always looking for ways to improve their city. That's why you get involved in the community. And so hopefully that's an opportunity where we're really getting people excited that yes, they really want to be part of this effort and stay involved because it's really meaningful. We'll talk about the process and proposed timeline. On the proposed timeline, we talked about what we would share. We thought it would not make sense to go through the whole timeline that we've developed in this draft one here that we presented at the last meeting. Instead, in order to make sure community expectations are, something that we can actually make sure we can commit to, we didn't want to put all that in there, but to just say that by August 2016, that we hope to have a draft of the charter. If you take a look at our timeline, by August, we should be finished reviewing, and really, the idea is to be ready with that draft. And I just wanted to point that out and see if there was anybody who had strong feelings any in particular way about that.
Going back to the presentation, CRC members, will we divide this up, these eight items, between the commissioners?
I think we could get a couple of commissioners who'd be willing to present, and maybe folks want to take certain parts. We can talk some more about that. Materials, so then we'll share a slide where we talk about all the materials that are in front of you, the 74 charter booklets, the handouts, so people know what they have with them. We'll talk about the advisory committee and really push support for that, getting involved through that method, as well as other ways to get involved.
She can't see.
And the live streaming of the meetings. Yes.
So you had asked for feedback on the timeline, right?
What do you think about the timeline?
I think another way to consider handling it is to still have all the steps and stuff, but just not include the dates. So these are all the steps we have to go through prior to a charter change actually occurring.
Steps without the dates. That does give more information, but it doesn't lock us into specifics. So that's, what do you guys think about that? Does that sound reasonable?
Another way of doing it is to leave the months on there, but just let people know that the timeline is subject to change, depending on discussion. That way, if someone is interested in a particular article, they'll know approximately when it will be discussed. Mm-hmm. Hopefully, they'll come to all the meetings, mm-hmm. but at least they'll have an idea on when that will be discussed.
Mm-hmm.
I think some dates are important just to keep us moving at a certain speed, that mm-hmm. we don't lock down and take up too much time on one particular item. Mm-hmm.
So if we put the timeline as it stands out there, but say that when we really get into it, if we feel we need to spend more time on a specific topic, we will take the time that we need to take.
Yes. Maybe just put on the top of it, subject to change.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, then I'm seeing nods, I'm feeling that there's consensus that we should put the timeline out there with the dates, subject to change, and really share that we're willing to be flexible depending on how much time it takes to work on specifics. Okay. All right, I see some nods and smiles, so I think that's good enough. Jim, do you have something to add?
Yeah, I do. I was trying to decide if I wanted to comment or not. I don't want to put us in a position where we get criticized for being off the timeline. That if something happens and we have to spend more time on in a particular area, that then is used as a way to create a negative image about the work that we're doing. Again, back to the earlier comments about trying to keep the public with us, but also wanting to have enough flexibility to study and do the job in a quality way that enables us to produce a quality document that's been carefully thought through and not caught up in a side issue of whether or not we're meeting the timeline that we set for ourselves or not. So I was looking for more flexibility, but I was almost didn't say anything, but that's how I feel.
I feel that I think people want to see time frames and get an idea of when we, how we will be working, and because we, you know, we have a 3-year period, and I don't want people to think that we're going to stretch it out 3 years. And so I think if we're upfront and transparent about the fact that it may change, I mean, we may get something done sooner. Mm-hmm. You know, so things may change, but I think if we're transparent about letting people know that, you know, this is not set in concrete, that there's a possibility that the timelines could change, but I think it's good to give them an idea of when and when we'll be doing, especially some of these articles, because as someone mentioned earlier, there's some articles people are going to be interested in and some not. Mm-hmm. So they may want to attend some of the sessions when we're doing finance and utilities and so forth.
On the timeline, you had talked about having or saying something to the effect of August, September is when we want to have a draft document. Was that, were you then going to kind of cut off the State of Michigan review outreach and us? I'm a little uncomfortable with having a timeline in which we've decided what election we're going to go for.
Yes, we could stop it there and then just talk in very general terms about this, that there is a state review required by law, and that there's going to need to be time for that and time for legal review, and then we have to figure out what election site, you know, election date that works. So yeah, I think we should not include those things. And part of it is we had a question that we didn't know the answer to, which was, when is the city council election? We wanted to make sure we were not going to be bringing this forward at the same time as whenever the next city council election is. So is it in 2017?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay.
So that's clear.
And Janelle, do you know, is that Paul? Well, oh, yeah, okay. All right.
Yeah, so that'd be it would be the primary in August and then the general election in November.
Okay, so that's something that we need to think about, because particularly we wouldn't want city council candidates to use the charter as platform for their
you don't want to politicize the charter process is what I think is a potential danger.
Yeah. Okay, good point. Okay. Also, we do have the ability to do some live streaming of our meetings, and so Paul Herring had proposed if any of us or a couple of us wanted to have like community conversation chats during our meetings. So if somebody wanted, if while we're meeting, questions are coming from the community, if anybody wanted to respond to them.
I think Commissioner McKenzie was going to say something before I jumped in.
I'm sorry.
But
I was just going to make a comment about the timeline. If the advisory committee is to not only to advise us, I can also see where they will be talking with their friends and family and constituents in the community. So if we were, one of these, say Article 1 went through November, that advisory committee will be letting people in the community know that that particular issue has been extended, we're still talking about it, et cetera, et cetera. So the public will still know well in advance if a certain discussion item is being extended beyond the timeline.
Right. Right. Good point. All right. So live streaming of meetings, does that, is there any interest in anybody chatting with folks during the commission meetings? How do you feel about that?
I think it's a good idea. I would be comfortable to support that if it was one of the commissioners needed, since I'm pretty tech savvy.
Yeah. Thanks for responding to my email already with the information.
Do what I can.
I think it would be helpful as a way to get more people involved, and if you, you know, have an issue with transportation or disability and you can't be here, this is a way you can be involved.
So this would be done through the website or email?
A live stream, right?
A live stream. Paul, I'm not into all that technology stuff on how that would work. I just know that it can happen.
Yeah, so it wouldn't be like on the city website, but the city would probably have a link to it, is what I'm guessing. Because live stream is like its own thing. And you can embed, but that might take IT coordination that
so
does
probably
not,
just be a link to where the live stream would take place,
But yeah, we do live streaming with our Natural Resource Commission meetings, and it works out very, very well.
Well, that's good for you tech-savvy folks.
Not tech-savvy enough to actually set it up, though.
I couldn't set it up.
Just to watch.
It's there. We know it exists. We don't know how to make it happen.
I'm not going to use it once someone creates it.
Okay, great. So the next piece would be after this presentation, and hopefully people have an understanding of what the charter is and the role of the commission and how they can get involved, we're going to work on this exercise of creating a shared vision of government. And this would be a table exercise with people at each table, led by a table facilitator, which I hope will be everyone in this room. I know Barry had said he cannot be there that day, so he's out, but I hope that all of the rest of us are willing to serve as a table facilitator during this exercise. And that's also one of the things in the email to respond to. So we would have large chart paper that's you can peel the sticky back off of it and stick to the wall after the exercise is done. And each one of the chart papers would say, what does good government look like? That'd be written on the top. And then somebody would be assigned from the folks who came to the session to be the recorder and to write out the ideas that are out there. Additionally, before this happens, we take 5 minutes to do individually think through those questions. So you have a sheet of paper that just has those questions, and you take a little bit of time to think to yourself what those things mean to you. You'd go through each one, spend probably 7 or 8 minutes on each, going around the table, making sure everybody has an opportunity to share their thoughts. Same thing with what does bad government look like? And then the third one would be, after that, what kind of qualities do you want to see in city government? We would then do a report out. We'd have each table pick a spokesperson, take their sheets to like the side of the room where we'd put them all on the wall, and have the folks go around and say a couple of the highlights from their sheets. We do want to record everything that we get out of the session. But during the report out, once people start talking, if a lot of things have already been said, you just kind of ask to share new information that hasn't been previously shared. And then after the report out, we wanted to hand out a survey. So we wanted to wait till the end to hand it out so people aren't focused on the survey during the other parts of the session. And the survey would be some of their thoughts today on the city of Flint Charter. We hope it'll give us sort of an idea of what the community's thoughts are, like a baseline pulse on where the community's at on some of the larger issues. We would also hope that if anybody wants to take it home and spend some more time thinking about it or do some research before they send it in, that that would be fine. That we would actually be taking surveys continuously through the end of October. And it could also be available online to fill out through an online survey thing like SurveyMonkey or services that automatically tally that stuff for you. And then we'd have paper copies out at other community places. People can pick it up and turn it into the clerk's office in City Hall. So the survey would be really, like I said, baseline, where people at today. And that'll help us get an understanding of where the community's at. If there was a student who wanted to help with any of these things from the, like the survey or helping on these other pieces, it would be great. And if there were any students that wanted to help out with table facilitation from the Ford School, you know, those would also be great opportunities. Then we would do a sort of here's where we're at, what's coming up next, maybe talk about, highlight our upcoming meetings from there. Thank everybody for coming. And that would be the session overall.
So was this drafted with the facilitator, or is this like what our starting spot in our discussion with the facilitator?
I drafted it and then shared it with her, and she gave some feedback and made some suggestions, and then we took it to the public outreach committee. We met last night, and there were some more suggestions and thoughts that were added in. So it's a work in progress.
Okay.
And if there are things that, you know, other ideas, this is only one way of many ways.
So I think I'm really happy with this. There are some things that I'd like to put some input in. I'm sorry I wasn't at the public outreach meeting.
That's okay.
Okay. I had a good excuse because my water heater died and I had to go shop for a new water heater. But a couple of thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if we got capacity, if we, you know, in best, worst, you know, best worst case scenario, right? Because we want a lot of people there.
Mm-hmm.
But if we do fill to capacity and, you know, we have 200 people in, mm-hmm. you know, minus us, you know, we could have upwards of, 20 groups that would be there to report out.
Mm-hmm.
And we would not be able, I don't think we'd be able to do a report out in 15 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And that's going to be a huge task, so I think we need to think through how to do that. I don't off the top of my head, I don't know quite how to handle it, you know, in the time frame, but I'm just thinking out loud here.
That's part of the way that the facilitator helps us, is so when we get into these situations, for instance, we have 200 people come and we have 20 full tables of 10, you know, she'll know folks in the community to tap and be like, you know, hey Jane Richardson, you want to do a table facilitation here for us and you help out in this way? Or instead of everybody report out, you know, share one thing off of your board.
Right,
everyone
and
go
also
around and share one thing.
Also reporting out, you know, one of the things we could, the facilitator can look at is there's a lot of duplication that will be
mm-hmm.
going on, so we can eliminate some of those that way.
Mm-hmm.
Our meeting space is going to hold how many people?
200.
And what if we're fortunate enough to have 300?
Squeeze them in. It'll look great.
Yeah, that'll be a great problem to have. But we are asking for RSVPs too. So if we start to see RSVPs going through the roof, and we are asking RSVPs go to the clerk, you know, call the clerk's office. This is where that phone line would come in handy. And so, yeah, there, we could end up with 300. Technically, capacity in the room is 400, so.
Yeah, just bring out more chairs.
Bring out more chairs.
UMM's got many, many chairs.
Great.
Yep. That would be a good problem to have.
Will the CRAC applications be available?
Oh, yes.
Passed out with the surveys?
Yeah, everyone will get one handed to them when they come in to create a packet that you get that talks about. We also talked about having a like an informational sheet that would answer some sort of more general questions about the charter. And there were some elements in the public outreach manual that we received from the, that was shared with this group early on, that there are some items in there that we wanted to have as printouts.
Also, I noticed we were earlier talking about the timeline. If we run out of time, I noticed that what you have printed here, there's an extra 10 minutes.
Yep.
So I think that will be enough facilitation time
in
case we need that extra time to report out.
Mm-hmm.
There's 10 minutes built in.
Yep.
Is there any other place besides the introduction that the clickers are going to be utilized in the?
Okay. No. I thought about that, and they can be kind of limiting because they only give you multiple choice options, and I really wanted our feedback to be more dynamic, sort of feeling oriented about the ways in which community members would like to see change happen. If I only give you five options, you know, it's why we put that in the front at the beginning.
Have you lined up who's giving welcoming remarks?
I'm sorry,
Have you lined up who's providing welcoming remarks? Any names?
Opening remarks?
It says welcoming remarks. Who? Who's giving welcoming remarks?
I was going to hope that maybe our chairperson would do that.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
And if the mayor shows up, or the president of city council, or any other dignitaries, will the facilitator know to ask them for 1 or 2 minute welcome?
1 minute. I mean, because we don't want them to take up the time that we set aside for public input.
Right.
Because they can also, sit at the tables and.
Mm-hmm. One way to do that is to just have somebody paying attention to the dignitaries that enter the room and hand Cleo a sheet and say, make sure to mention. We're thankful that these folks have joined us today, and with us here we have raise their hand, and so that they're recognized. We also have to be cognizant of not taking up too much time on the agenda.
Right, we only have a couple hours.
Right. When we let one speak, then we gotta let them all speak. I know this is a lot to do when you're really cold and shivering in space.
I'm fine today.
You're fine today?
It's not as bad as it has been.
Is this meeting going to be taped?
Videotaped? Yep, Paul will be recording.
Okay. I would just like to volunteer my time if ever we need photography. Still shots.
I think it would be great to have still
shots. Would you be willing to bring your camera and get some photos during the activities and kind of like
would be
just be there with the camera and
all that would be great.
Yes. That would be really great. Thank you.
You do?
Anything? I know that's a lot. That's all that I have.
Okay, then there are no more questions for the Public Outreach Committee. We're going to move on to old business. And the Commissioner, anything from Pontiac?
No, I think we should take that off the list.
All right.
Off the agenda.
We'll take it off of the next meeting.
And we've already talked about the 1974 Charter Review Commissioners. Rules of procedure.
No report.
No report, okay. Is there any additional business to be brought before the commission? And I have some information from the clerk. And she states that she and Davina will need copies of flyers, brochures, letters, and anything else that will need to be kept for the permanent file. Okay, all right, all three.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. All right, and also they get the phone calls. And again, the website is up and running. Okay, so any materials we have, we need to include them so that they'll be with the permanent record.
Janelle? I'm handing Janelle the letters that were sent to the four 1974 Charter Commissioners for the record.
We were supposed to be in the committee room, but I'm sorry, and I know everybody's freezing, but the reason we were not was because Paul was not here, and so the gentleman that's doing the video is not familiar with the setup in the committee room. Okay. So that's why we had to come in here today.
Thank you. I have one more item to share. It's really just for everybody's information. I know I had talked a little bit ago about as a student of the Masters of Public Administration program at University of Michigan Flint, I would be doing an independent study on the public outreach process so that I can continue to move towards my degree but not, you know, have to set that aside for this process. So my advisor approved that and I can be doing some of that work, and I hope that there are ways to get more University of Michigan Flint students involved, and we did talk about that a little bit today.
Okay, thank you for being transparent.
Yep.
Is there anything else?
Yeah. Do we need to sign a waiver for you to use us for your classwork? Unless things have changed, when I was at U of M, we always had to have people sign waivers to use their opinions, voice, picture, what have you, and be placed in our papers.
I was told there's a board, the IRB board, that my advisor is going to basically try and see if that's even necessary. We'll see.
Yeah, thanks for
okay, our next meeting is September 24th, and the next Finance Committee meeting is
22nd.
And rules?
14.
14?
Yes, 14.
Okay, and public outreach?
Well, okay. So normally we would not meet until two more weeks from now, but I would like to schedule a meeting for early next week so that we can continue to be prepared and discuss. So you're meeting on the 14th. Is anybody meeting on the 16th or the 17th? Basically, from the folks here that are here today, on Wednesday or Thursday next week.
The 16th is what day?
16th is Wednesday. The 17th is Thursday. On those, between those two dates.
Oh, well, either day would be fine.
Do you have a preference?
I'll be out of
Thursday,
town.
Commissioner McKenzie. Thursday.
Yes.
Okay.
Thursday?
Okay, so that'll be the
Thursday the 17th. And if we do it at 6 o'clock, John, does that give you enough time to get here? Okay. All right, that's what we'll do.
6 o'clock to 7.
Okay. So now
do a notice. All right.
So
it's official.
Will the next week's meeting remain on the schedule?
And then we're going to meet again on the 21st to basically everything needs to be okay. Ready to go by then.
All right.
I think between those two meetings we can flesh out the rest of the pieces of this. Okay. And everyone is encouraged to attend the Public Outreach Committee meeting on the 17th.
It would be good.
I would say I plan on being there at 9 a.m. That's an hour before the meeting. There'll be some setup involved. Thank you.
Okay. Anything else to come before the commission?
Yes. One last thing. Can we add our calendar to the website as well, our calendar of meetings?
It's supposed to be, isn't that added? But we had to create a calendar first because everything was,
oh, okay.
All of our meetings are on the city's website calendar.
Oh, okay.
If you go on the city's website, there's three news stories, and then it says more. If you click on that, you get the whole calendar.
Okay.
I believe all of the committees and the commission are on there through December. I also have hard copies that I sent to everybody else to input.
Mm-hmm.
I believe we'll need to schedule the, I think it's the December meeting we need to set.
And then the
for the general?
It says December 10th or 17th.
Right, we need to decide on that. So at the next meeting, we'll decide on the which date for December.
We can do that. I understand that when the public notices go out, they also send them to the press. So the media knows we're meeting.
Maybe now that we're getting our meetings more scheduled, we can send, especially to the courier, we could send the next couple of months worth. Mm-hmm. And we can still do flyers.
Yep.
At our various churches and meeting places and community meetings, agencies, mm-hmm. beauty and barbershops.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Anything else?
Yes. I'm a member of a nonprofit organization, Motherly Intercession, and I want to put a group picture of the commission in a book that they are publishing for November. It's not going to cost anybody anything. I just need a time when I can take a picture.
Well, I also said that we have one coming, the photographer took one. But when she supplied the disc of all non-individual pieces, she did not give us that picture.
Well, I would rather take another one. I didn't like the setup she had here anyway.
So could you take it at the next general meeting?
Yes.
Okay. Did everyone agree?
You're still going to be in it, right?
Pardon?
Are you going to be in the picture with us?
Yes.
Oh. Great.
Okay. Nothing else? Someone move for it, Jerry?
So move.
All in favor?
Aye.